So we have seen what we can do with convolution and linear filters, but there are many situations when we may want to depart from linear filtering and develop non-linear filters, which cannot be implemented as convolutions. So here is an example. Let's start with the problem of smoothing an image to remove noise. So here you have an image which has some salt and pepper noise in it. You see these white and black dots. These are scattered over the image, but very strong, very prominent. We want to remove this, obviously, from an image before we further process it. In doing so, we want to preserve the information on these coins, which we'll treat as our signal. Well, if you simply apply a fuzzy filter or a Gaussian to this, you can see that you sort of diminish the noise a little bit, but what you're really doing is smearing the noise out. You're not really removing it, and at the same time, you're losing some of the details on the coins. So the problem with smoothing is it doesn't really remove the outliers, the salt and pepper noise, and at the same time, you're actually smoothing out the edges, blurring out the images, the edges. So now we're going to take a different approach, and that's called median filtering. It's more of an algorithmic approach. You take a pixel that you want to find the value for, and you look at its neighborhood, let's say k by k. You take all of these k squared intensity values in the image, and you sort them. And after you sort them, you find the middle value, and that is the median of that set of intensity values. And you simply output the median as the intensity at that pixel. This is called median filtering. Let's see what that does. Well, here is our salt and pepper noise in the image. And when you apply median filtering with even a small filter, k is equal to 3, you see that you get a pretty nice result. Pretty much all the noise is gone. You do lose a little bit of detail on the coins, but it's a pretty impressive result for a very small mask, very small filter, 3 by 3. So the thing to note here is that you cannot implement a filter like this using convolution. It's more algorithmic in nature, and so therefore it is a non-linear filter. So let's see how far we can push this idea. Is this really a magical filter? Well, if you look at an image with more realistic noise in it, you might see it right here, which means that literally every pixel has noise in it, different levels of noise. This is the type of noise that you typically get when you take an image under low light conditions, say, for instance. In this case, one needs to use a bigger median filter. And when you do that, yes, you do improve, reduce the noise, but if you look at this background carefully enough, you'll see a texture in the background. So it's not fully removed, the noise itself. And the price that you're paying is, of course, the details on the coins are lost quite a bit. And now if you go to an even bigger filter, yes, you do better in terms of the noise reduction itself, but a lot of the details are gone. You wouldn't be able to distinguish between these coins for sure. So what you really want to do is to take the best of these two worlds. One is Gaussian smoothing on one side, which is a linear operator, and median filtering on the other side. And try and come up with an algorithm or a filter that does a lot better than either one of these. So for that, let's revisit Gaussian smoothing. Let's see what's wrong with Gaussian smoothing. So here's an image, input image, which is grainy. It has noise in it. You can see that right here, noise. And you're going to apply a Gaussian convolution to it, Gaussian smoothing. That's your kernel, fairly large kernel. And when you do that to the entire image and you just crop out this small part, which corresponds to this part right here, you get this. And for this one, you get this and this. So in the case of this flat region, which has all of this noise in it, you do extremely well. You get a very nice smooth region. In the case of this region with the digits 1 and 0, it's all washed out. And the same applies to this one as well. So we understand this already, the downside of using Gaussian smoothing. And the image, the final result looks like this. So the reason this happens is because we're using the same filter at all pixels, independent of the context that lies around the pixel itself. So if you can now design a filter that can modify the kernel, its kernel gets modified depending on the structure of the image locally, what the neighborhood of a pixel looks like, you're essentially willing to create a new filter for each pixel, then you can do a lot better. So let's take a simple example here. Let's say we want to continue to use Gaussian smoothing, but we're going to do something different here, which is we only use for Gaussian smoothing at any given pixel those pixels that are similar in intensity to this pixel. If any pixel is very different in intensity, so let's say that this brightness value is 100 and this one happens to be 200, that's too far away. We don't want it to influence the final output. So if you do that, you see that now you have a smaller set of pixels that we want to use, which have brightness similar to that of the center pixel. And so now we're only going to use that part of the Gaussian kernel. Now, of course, remember that when you do that, you want to normalize the Gaussian kernel so that you don't change the brightness of the image. You always want to normalize such that the area under the kernel is one. And in this case, you have a white pixel here, and in modifying that pixel and computing the actual value of the output of that pixel, you don't want to be using the pixels that lie on these dark regions. So you see that those regions are removed from the kernel, and then you end up getting this. And in this case, virtually all the pixels are similar in value to the center pixel, so they all get used. The Gaussian kernel doesn't change much, and you end up with this output right here. So here is a little hack we introduced. And you can see that by simply biasing the Gaussian kernel such that pixels not similar in intensity to the center pixels receive lower weight, in our case we've given them weight of 0, that can take you a long distance. This is your input image and this is your output image, and you can see that you get a very clean output image. So what we would like to do is to find a principal way of doing this, and that brings us to the bilateral filter. So in the case of the bilateral filter, here's what we're doing. Here's your image, and here is your mask. And this mask is your usual spatial Gaussian. So far what you're seeing here is just a convolution with a spatial Gaussian. It's Gaussian smoothing. For now, just ignore this factor right here, which is your normalization factor. We'll come back to this later. So now in this case, if you want to filter this input image, which you can see is an edge, it's very noisy on both sides, with this spatial Gaussian, you can see that if you're going to place this Gaussian at this location right here, what's going to happen is that this point, the yellow point, is of course going to have a large weight, as it should because it's close by. And that makes sense because it's actually on the same side as the edge. However, the green point that you see here is going to be given the same weight despite the fact that it's on the other side of the edge. That doesn't make sense, and that's exactly the problem you're trying to solve. But in any case, if you apply this filter, the Gaussian smoothing, to this image, you end up with this as expected. You get an image which is much smoother, much less noise, but the edge has been completely blurred out. So what we're going to do is to add another term in here, which we'll call the brightness Gaussian, right here. So what's happening now is you're going to add a brightness, a Gaussian, which is going to act on the brightness difference between the pixel that you're operating on, which is IJ, and the neighboring pixel, MN. So if this is IJ and this is MN, it's taking the difference between the brightnesses of those two points and saying that if that brightness is small, then you're going to give it a large weight because that's what the Gaussian does. if that brightness difference is very large, you're going to give it a low weight, which is what the Gaussian does. So what happens here is that in applying the spatial Gaussian, it's going to be weighted for each pixel in such a way that you end up getting a final filter that looks like this. You can see that it is a Gaussian-shaped filter, which remains a Gaussian on the side of the edge that this point lies on, the point where you're applying the operator. And then it gets literally truncated on the other side, thereby implying that all of these pixels on this side are not going to contribute to the output that's being computed for this pixel. It's more the points on this side that are going to be contributing to it. So when you do that, you get a very clean output. You see that the noise has been diminished substantially, and at the same time, the edge is preserved. So that is bilateral filtering, and it's become a very common type of filtering applied in many different domains, because what it has is this ability to conform or to adapt the filter based on the content around the pixel. So it is literally changing as you go, as a result of which you simply cannot implement it as a convolution because it is a constantly changing filter, but the upside is that it gives you very nice results. Now let's take a look at this. This is something that we set aside, which is this weighting function. That's very important because irrespective of what the shape, how complex the shape of the filter is, what you want to make sure is that the energy in the filter is always equal to one, right? So you want to change this weighting function as you go, and that's done by simply summing up the product of the brightness Gaussian and the spatial Gaussian. In other words, you end up getting the weights that are used for all the pixels in the window. You add them all up, and that's going to be what you normalize the output with. So let's take a look at how this works on images. Once again, I should mention that the bilateral filter is a nonlinear operator. It simply cannot be implemented as a convolution. So here is an example. Here you see an original image, and this image has some noise in it. If you look closely, you'll see that it is grainy. We want to remove this noise without losing the details of the features. So if you apply Gaussian filtering, smoothing with a sigma equal to 2, you see that you get a slightly blurry image. The noise hasn't been entirely removed. But now if you use a bilateral filter with a sigma for the spatial Gaussian of 2, same as this, but a sigma for the brightness Gaussian of 10, you get a very nice image where literally all the noise has been removed. And at the same time, most of the spatial features have been preserved. If you look at this area here, yes, you do lose a little bit of information, but by and large, especially in the case of the eyes and the mouth, all the salient features are preserved and you get a very nice output. Now, what happens when you change these two sigmas? So if you increase the spatial sigma to 4, you get a much blurrier image in the case of Gaussian smoothing. You still get a pretty sharp image in the case of bilateral filtering. Again, a little bit more of the image, the information or the details are removed, but fairly acceptable result. If you increase it further, you see that you sort of start getting this painterly effect where shaded regions start getting flatter and flatter. There's this watercolorish look to it. And in fact, you can see that in the hair region particularly. But still, this is a much nicer output than this one right here, which is the result of just pure smoothing. And now we can ask, what happens when you change? We have held the sigma for the brightness Gaussian to be 10 all the way through. What happens when you change that? So let's say that the spatial sigma is 6 and the brightness sigma is 10. We get this result here. If you increase the brightness sigma to 20, you get this. A little bit more blurring. But as you increase it further and further, let's say you use a really large number, really the brightness Gaussian becomes flat. So it has no effect. It's essentially saying the weight is one, irrespective of the difference in brightness between the center pixel and the pixel that you're looking at. And essentially, your bilateral filter begins to behave like a Gaussian filter, as expected.